The competition of Indian companies will take. We have to accept the acquisitions which will increase the market. Now, impact of proposed policy. See, we are just reading that there is a proposed policy of restricting FDIs to 49%. This is likely to put brakes on the liberalization of the FDI companies which are planning to put FDIs in India. Is there a guarantee that prices can be kept under control with a cap on FDI alone in the event of merger? Besides, if an MNC has the 49% stake in a company, can it not control the business? Any restriction on FDI in pharma could make overseas investment even in R&D sector less attractive. Protectionism is harmful as it will make domestic industry lethargic and uncompetitive. It will have a chilling effect on the FDI flow of the country, not only in the pharma sector, but also on other sectors. The government should be more cautious now when the foreign direct investment has already fallen by about 36%. The correct view, you see, putting cap on FDI is not a solution for an emerging economy like India, but keeping a check and balances to facilitate the deployment of these investments for creating new capability is the right solution. Let us monitor the green project investment rather than the brownfield investment. Let us take a review of the price control. The concern of government behind price control is government invoke price control to ensure that the medicines are sold at fair price to protect citizens from exploitation. Is it achievable? Now, NPPA role. You see, it is the job of the NPPA to keep prices under control and act as a watchdog. NPPA has indeed contributed immensely to make the prices of drugs affordable to the public. No doubt, how did you see from 1970 onwards? In 1979, there were 347 drugs under price control, having market share of 80 to 90%. Out of these, 40%, 50%, 100% of the market allowed to various categories, for life-saving 40%, for essential 50%, and for non-essential 100%. In 1987, the reduced number of drugs under control is 142, with a market share of 60 to 70%, and with two markups, 70% and 100%. In 1995, they reduced the drugs to 74, with market share of 25 to 30%, and with 100% markup. In 2002, 20-25 drugs and 10 to 20% is the market share with 100% or more markups. See, now see what is the effect of this. As the government decontrol the drugs, the manufacture of the formulations and bulk drugs have gone up tremendously. You see. Again, see what the other effects are there. If you see profitability, it's definitely gone up after that period. Then capital investment has also increased over a period of time. Then exports, they have gone up tremendously. And total export drug formulations has also gone up subsequently. Now, what are negative effects of the price control? See, disrupting supply and demand. Though the drug price control order was set up to ensure the availability and the accessibility of the medicines, it has ended up driving out the market globally recognized drugs that were in any case affordable. It did this by driving prices down to such level where firms were unable to supply. Serious problems also result when government set prices below the equilibrium level. This causes consumers to want more of the product than produce have. Prices control reduce entry and investment in long run. This control can also reduce the quality. Reduction in the innovation of the formulations. The drug price issue affects development of the pharma industry. There is a lack of transparency where actual cost of the industry are not taken into account. The items of daily necessities like food, shelter, clothing, education, doctor's fees, and hospital charges, there is no price control. then why there is a control only on medicines? Is it necessary to have price control? Any innovative product will be high priced in the beginning to cover the R&D cost and can certainly become cheaper once it becomes generic. It is important for the government to cover as many people as possible under health insurance and provide cover for critical illness and costly drugs. We can suggest novel idea like levy sugar, in which 15% of the production of sugar factories required to be given at control price to the government for public distribution system. Rest 85% is left to the factories to sell at open market. Now, why not have such concept in the pharma industry? See, you cover a certain section of population and advise companies to give X percentage to the government at control price and leave rest to the open competition. Conclusion, to conclude, we can say FDI are not deterrent for growth and globalization of Indian healthcare industry. However, price control seems to be deterrent. Thank you.
I keep asking all the questions, so for a change, let's see if there are any questions to Mr. Sinde from the floor. Anybody has any thought process, any question to ask Mr. Sinde? Okay, so I think that was a talk very well delivered, that means, yeah. Thank you very much for a very informative talk. Yes, indeed, FDI is not a deterrent. Price control is always a debate that the industry has times over. We now move across to a very interesting subject, and we've got a person who specializes in speaking on this, and he's himself, I think, over a period of time, differentiated and succeeded so much. The subject is Differentiate or Die, Pharmaceutical Industry in India. And to speak to us on that, we've got Mr. Deepak Nayak, who is currently the Managing Director, Health and New Therapeutics Limited. And Mr. Deepak Nayak, prior to this, has held important positions and was previously the managing director of the Japanese company Eisai for India. And prior to that, has held high positions in Wockhardt, Ranbaxy, etc. So please welcome Mr. Deepak Nayak, who is going to talk to us on a very interesting topic, Differentiate or Die, which is actually taking a cue from a lot of things that the earlier speakers have said during the course of the day. Deepak, please.
First of all, I would like to thank for giving me this opportunity to speak here. Speaking to a hall not full of audience is difficult, with very few people around. But I would like to make my topic interesting so that those who are here do not repent of being here, but we'll feel that they have got something from this topic and discussion. Differentiate or Die is not my line. It was stated by Al Rice and Jack Trout when they proposed their very famous principle now of positioning. All of us know Darwin's theory, survival of the fittest. Do you think this is true? One scientist in Russia challenged the theory. And he said it is not survival of the fittest. It is something else. And he wrote a landmark book, The Struggle for Existence, Professor G.F. Gauss. He conducted us a small experiment to prove that it is not survival of the fittest. He took two test tubes. In one, he put all the food that is required to survive and put protozoas of same species and put it for incubation. After 15 days, he took the test tube out and tested. He found that some protozoas have survived, some have died. So he concluded Darwin's theory is right, that the fittest have survived and the weak protozoas have died. He conducted one more experiment. He took one more test tube, put all the food that was required, and this time he put protozoas of two different species. Kept it for 15 days, took it out, and he found that protozoas of two different species both survived. Nobody died. The conclusion that he drew was that it is not survival of the fittest. If your source of living is different, both will survive. If your source of living is same, none will survive, because they will fight for the same resource, and the resource in this world is not available in plenty. You have seen this in the earlier talk. The resource is very, very scarce. So is it survival of the different? Let us go ahead. हमारे हिंदी में एक कहावत है, एक म्यान में दो तलवारें नहीं रह सकती. सही है? So if you have to fight, you cannot have two swords, because they will do the same job. Both are not required. Only one is required. If you want to have a successful fight, then you need one sword which will kill and one shield which will defend. तो तलवार और ढाल एक साथ में रह सकती है, दो तलवार एक मैन में नहीं रह सकते. So if you have to survive, it is survival of the different together, not the same. When two people come together and decide that they will stay together throughout the life, it is never two people of the same species. It is not male-male. If it is there, then it is something odd. It is male and female. Two different species come together and stay together for life. Even in boss and subordinate, if the strength of the boss is also the strength of subordinate, they will fight. If the strength of the boss is weakness of subordinate, and weakness of the boss is strength of subordinate, they will complement perfectly to each other. So what we are talking here is complementary competence and not competitive competence. So whether it is true in business or relationship, the truth is it is survival of the difference and not the same. Let us enter into one more debate. Do you agree God created man? How many agree God created man? How many? There are some who believe that in the beginning, man created God. Do you agree? Man created God. You agree? I do. Because man thought that if everybody is human being in this earth, there has to be somebody who is different. There has to be somebody who is beyond man and mankind. Somebody whom mankind will listen to. Somebody whom mankind will bow. Somebody whom man will go and narrate what he has done wrong. Somebody who will be afraid of that imaginary thing, which is God. So I believe man created God so that God is different, and because he is different, man will listen to him. So even creation of God is because of difference. Man did not stop at that. Man did not stop at creating one God, different than man. And he created different gods. Why do you think he created different gods?